Good afternoon and welcome to the GNLCC. Here's Rick.
Thanks, Leslie. To begin with, I'd like to introduce myself. I think probably a lot of folks, at least in the room here, know me. I serve as one of the science coordinators for the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative. Sean Fenn is the other. And we're in the process of trying to establish some priorities for the Great Northern LCC, but that's a long-term process, and it's a changing process. And what we're trying to do in this initial stage is provide information so that the steering committee can begin to think about what some of those priorities might be and how they might establish some of those priorities. I'd like to start with the outline. First of all, we're going to do a little brief overview of the Great Northern landscape. Talk about some of the assumptions of doing this swap analysis. Leslie's going to then take over and describe some of the procedures that we used and provide some of the results along with me. And we'll look at some maps of the common species. We'll then look at some of the habitats that the swap analysis has provided and then look at the common ones across the LCC. And then just real briefly talk about some next steps that we might think about. To begin with, I'd like to acknowledge Greg Watson. It was really Greg's idea to begin to look at the state swaps as a way of thinking about what species were common across the Great Northern landscape so that we could begin to use that in our analyses and thought process. So thanks, Greg, and I think that what you're going to be seeing here today was presented to the steering committee, the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative Steering Committee a few months ago, and again as a way of beginning to entertain this idea of what does the Great Northern look like and what are some of the common species that exist across the states. If we look at the Great Northern, there's about 286 million acres total. In the U.S. portion is about 163 million acres. About 38% of that is scrub, shrub, and grassland, and about 35% evergreen forest. And 38% scrub, shrub, and 13% grassland. That scrub, shrub in the Great Northern often includes sage steppe. And so there, you can see that in this case, we often think of the Great Northern as being a forested landscape, but it's clearly much more than that, and I think you'll see that from the list of species and from the habitats as we go on. In terms of ownership within the Great Northern landscape, the federal ownership is about 89 million acres. Next is the private ownership, about 57 million acres. State ownership is about 8.5 million. Native American, about 6 million, et cetera. You can see those figures there. I think the Great Northern is somewhat unique, at least not so much in the West, but a lot of the Western LCCs are unique in that they really have a great federal presence and a lot of federal land, and I think that's an important thing to understand about not only the Great Northern, but much of the West. In terms of the actual agencies amongst the that own land in the West, you'll see that about the equal amounts of the U.S. portion of the Great Northern are owned either by the Forest Service or by private entities, about 22 million acres each. A Bureau of Land Management has about 9 million acres, and the states about 3.5 million, and the tribes about 2.5 million, and you can see, go on down there and understand a little bit more about what land ownership is. Thought that would be another part of the good introduction of understanding the Great Northern. So, what are the state wildlife action plans? If you're interested, you can go to wildlifeactionplans.org and you can explore the generalities of state wildlife action plans, and you can actually download each of the individual state wildlife action plans if you're interested in seeing what is going on in a particular state. But essentially, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service funded the states through state wildlife grants to prepare what they call state wildlife action plans. And they were an attempt to identify the species of greatest conservation need in the states, along with the habitats that support those particular species, as a way of thinking about key species in the individual states. One of the things that the state wildlife action plans tried to focus on was sort of a focus on non-game interests. Up until this point, to a large degree, and not certainly not entirely by any stretch of the imagination, but much of the wildlife activity throughout the U.S. was focused on harvestable species for various reasons, and the attempt interest by the states was to begin to think about some of their non-game species as well. And so this was sort of an attempt to do that, and I think a fairly successful one as it developed. So the purpose of the swap analysis that we did was to provide an understanding of species common across the states as identified through those state wildlife action plans. Second was to provide sort of a coarse understanding of where those species exist on the Great Northern landscape, and as well, in a general sense, to provide an overview of key habitats. There are a number of underlying assumptions and observations that we'd like to point out right from the start. The first one is that state wildlife grants that funded the swaps did not consider most hunted species. Just so that when you begin to look, if you begin to look at any of the state wildlife action plans yourself, you might say, you know, why isn't the mallard or why isn't this species or that species included? And part of that was the intent from the initial part, initial stage, to focus on non-game species. As those state wildlife action plans are being revised over time, many of the states are beginning to include other species as well, and it's beginning to get more and more comprehensive as time goes on. And like anything else, as you begin to delve into it more and more, you begin to realize that the kind of things that can really benefit from this kind of analysis. And so that's what the states have been doing as well, along with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. The second assumption is that provincial, Canadian Wildlife Service, federal agencies outside the Fish and Wildlife Service, tribal, First Nations, and NGO established lists of species are not considered here. You know, that would make it more complete, more holistic. Our attempt wasn't necessarily to do that. Our attempt was to take a sort of a first cut using those state wildlife action plans. I guess we've got a number one. I don't know how that happened, but that goes. But number three, a third assumption, was that the Great Northern LCC Fish and Wildlife Service species that are included in this analysis were those species that were identified in the strategic habitat conservation discussions before sort of landscape conservation cooperatives came into being. Those species are not really, those lists are not really considered definitive in terms of being Fish and Wildlife Service or GNLCC top priorities, but there was a lot of vetting, a lot of public process that went into those, establishing those lists, and we felt that they were really fairly equivalent to a lot of the state wildlife action plans, maybe not quite as comprehensive of look at things, but we felt that it was a good effort to include that. And part of what happened also is that in the initial stages, very, very initial stages of forming the LCCs, particularly the Great Northern, there was a fact sheet put out and it listed those species, and we felt that people were already thinking about some of those species. And what you'll see as we go through this, there's quite a bit of overlap between those species that were identified during that strategic habitat conservation effort, along with this, as well as with the state swap analysis. Our fourth observation that we'd like to point out is that the advisory team, which is sort of a technical team advising the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative, added some hunted species to reflect the priorities, an attempt to reflect the priorities of all the entities that are involved in the Great Northern, especially the states and as well as the Intermountain West Joint Venture. I think there was something else I wanted to mention here, and I can't think what it was now. We'll go on and maybe I'll think about it later. These are the basic steps that we used in doing the swap analysis. First, we downloaded all the data and merged the swap species. Then we went through and identified the swap ranges, the ranges of the various species, and then we took a brief look at habitats. And from here, I'm going to turn the microphone over to Leslie, and she will continue and talk about procedures.
Great. Thanks, Rick. So I'm just going to give you a brief overview of how I did this, and then I'm going to run you through a couple examples. This was all Excel wizardry. I don't claim to be a wizard, but it's all good. Okay, so the first thing I did is I downloaded all of the swap lists from the NBI website, and I'll show you what that looks like. They came to me as Excel spreadsheets. And then I merged them all into one workbook so that they were a little bit easier to work with. And then I sorted the data by scientific name, removed the duplicates, and you'll see why I did that in a minute. And then resorted it by common name to recheck for duplicates and looking at any sort of taxonomic errors that might be there. Then I deleted all the non-GNLCC states listed. Each of these lists had every single state that the species had ever been listed in a swap in. And you'll see it was really cumbersome to sort of visually look at all of that. So I just cleaned it up a little bit. Then I added the GNLCC and Fish and Wildlife Service priority species. Then I performed logic and reference functions. It's my fancy way of saying I just counted everything. So I counted everything to identify species inclusion in each of the swaps and the Fish and Wildlife's priority list. And then from that, the species got a ranking of either 1 to 6. And I'll show you how I was able to score those. So then I selected species that ranked a 4 or more, meaning that they were in 4 or more swaps and the GNLCC. And then I copied them to a new spreadsheet to make it easier to work with. And then we sorted the species in descending order so that we could see what we had. Okay, so just to give you a little bit of overview on the swaps themselves, here's the total number of species of greatest conservation need that are included in each swap. And you can see that the states had pretty they were pretty even across the board. Idaho had 229 species, Montana 212, Oregon 286, Washington 178, and Wyoming had 279 species. And then there was the additional 12 that we included from the Fish and Wildlife Service. And here's a breakdown of invertebrates versus inverts. And this is a wildlife action plan, so there were no plants, except Oregon was pretty thorough and included plants. And they also included habitats and ecoregions, which really helped when we did the habitat crosswalk, which I'll talk about in just a little bit. Okay, so here's the NBII website. This is where I went to get all of the lists. And if you're going to do this for your state, get it quick, because I understand that the future of the NBII is uncertain at best. But it was really great that they put all of these together, and it made comparing the data across the states real easy because everything came in the same format. So I downloaded all the lists, and this is what they look like when I got them.
If you have an interest in the Great Northern list and you can't get them from NBII because the websites are going away, just contact us, and we can give you those in that spreadsheet format.
That's right. And I also, as an aside, did this same counting, if you will, for the North Pacific LCC. So they have this, and I have all of their lists as well if you're in the North Pacific. Okay, so here's what the lists look like when I got them out of NBII. So this is sort of them in their raw form. You can see that everything's sorted by a scientific name, common name. They have assigned a taxonomic category. And then here's what I was talking about. There's lots of states listed. And so for me, this was really visually kind of messy. And so I needed to clean it up a little bit. And I did. So what I did, after I merged them all together and did all the sorting and deleting of duplicates, I then took each taxonomic category and gave it its own worksheet so that, again, the data was just a little bit easier for me to deal with. It wasn't so cumbersome. And this is what all of that sorting and counting looked like. So across the bottom of this of your screen, you'll see that I have things categorized by birds, mammals, fish, amphibians and reptiles, and aquatic invertebrates. The counts fancy wizardry that I did in Excel was pretty easy. You all know this function. It's just the count if function. So for each cell, I assigned, I did a count if, and if this, that state was included in the swap, then it scored a 1. So a state got either, or a species got a 1 or a 0 if it was included in the swaps. And that count if function is super helpful if you do anything like this. So then I was able to score the species, and then I sorted them by number, by their score, and selected all of the species that scored a 4 or higher. And this is what we got. So you can see that there are 3 species that scored a 6, meaning they were included in all the swaps, and they were included in the GNLCC Fish and Wildlife Service list. Those species are the burrowing owl, the greater sage grouse, and the Lewis woodpecker. So there are 3 species there. Then there were 13 species that scored 5, meaning they were included in 4 swaps and the GNLCC, or in all 5 swaps. So there was 2 ways for species to score a 5. And I've outlined those for you here. And you can see we start to pick up mammals and fish and amphibians with this score of 5. And then also we looked at species that scored 4. That's the next slide. And here are those species that scored a 4. So none of those species were in the GNLCC, Fish and Wildlife Service list, but we just were continuing to look and see how many species were in each swap.
We might add that one of the reasons we did that is we wanted to include those that were in 4 swaps so that we didn't overlook any of the priorities that the states were having, and they had equal priority or maybe greater priority than an original strategic habitat conservation list.
Excellent. So then what Rick and I did is we looked at the species that scored 5 or higher, combined them, and then Rick took this list to the advisory team, and that's where we have the additional species that are primarily game-oriented species. But you can see across the bottom of the screen that, again, pretty equal representation by all states. Washington had 17 species that made this list, Oregon 15, Idaho 17, Montana 16, Wyoming 18. You can see here we've added back in the 12 GNLCC list species. The advisory team added 3, and then there was an additional 4 added from the Intermountain West Joint Venture. So this attempted to capture, as Rick said earlier, some broader conservation priorities, especially those species that are important for game. So then once we had the species list, then Tara Chesley-Preston took over and did some spatial analysis. And my background is not in ARC, so I'm going to do my best to describe what she's done. And it was really kind of nice. What we wanted to know was, what's the spatial distribution of these species? Remember, we're just talking about those 27 that we ended up with. And what are the common types of land cover amongst the species ranges? This was a very broad first stab at what does the landscape essentially look like. And we're looking at spatial distribution, and we realized that it eventually started to tell us something about species richness across the landscape. So we just wanted to know, essentially, how many species there are in a given area of these 27. So the way that Tara did this is she acquired the species range maps from NatureServe, and so for those 27 species, she clipped the species ranges maps to the GNLCC, and then she removed those species from the states that did not include the species in their swaps. So that sounds like a lot of Sibyllic S-ing happening, but what she did was she made sure that the species that she was looking at were the ones that were included in each swap within the GNLCC. And I think you'll see that in a little bit. It'll be more clear. She merged the species range data and then counted and mapped the number of species of importance for each region.
So essentially, by clipping the range maps to these states that included those species in their swaps, we were making sure that we didn't include a species in a state with that state where that state did not include it in their swap analysis. Just another way of saying what Leslie just said, but
right.
We want to emphasize that.
Okay. So here's an example of a species range map that she got from NatureServe. This is for the trumpeter swan. And you can see this is the range map. Goes all the way up into British Columbia, so we do have some data for that. And then, so this is what they look like when she got them. This is the first stab that she took at doing some species distribution. And these groupings, you can see there's 6 groupings here of 1 to 12 species, 13 to 15, 16 to 17. Those groupings were based on natural breaks in the data. And so we started looking at it with that sort of more fine grouping. And this is what the data look like, or what the range look like without clipping to the states. You can see that there's definite areas where there's more species richness or higher numbers of species. And then she clipped them to the states for the next one. You can see there's a little bit of change there. So again, if that species was not included in the swap, then she took it out of the spatial analysis. So then we decided to look at this again with more coarse groupings. So we looked at 1 to 15 species, 16 to 19, and 20 to 27, because we weren't altogether sure that that more fine grouping of species was really telling us anything. And again, it gives you a really nice visual here, and of course data from ARC, on where the most species are of these 27 species. So this map here is where Tara went ahead and clipped. She clipped it, the species range, to the GNLCC, or the state boundaries again, excluding species from states that did not include them in their swap analysis.
Another thing to point out in this slide is that we have included these species, those 27 species ranges from NatureServe for Alberta and British Columbia, but we don't have the ability to either say that they're a priority species for those provinces because, of course, they haven't gone through the swap analysis like we have in the states, or at least we haven't investigated whether they have a similar kind of process and a similar kind of list that we might use, but it wasn't identical. So we just included those entire ranges in the two provinces.
Great. Thank you. Okay, so after we did the species richness spatial distribution analysis, we thought we would go back, revisit the swaps, and look more specifically at habitat, because I don't know that we were getting what we wanted to just by looking at the range maps. So luckily, each state did address habitat and prioritized habitat that was important for their conservation. Each state also did it very differently, and I'm going to walk you through the process for that. This took a little bit more sleuthing and required a little bit more in-depth look at the habitat. So they had the leniency to be able to do it as it functioned for them and their conservation needs. So this is a picture of the sort of the overview of Oregon. I'll show you exactly how Oregon prioritized their habitat and made it real easy. So they, as all the states did, had identified ecoregions. And so what I was able to do for each ecoregion is determine whether or not it was in the GNLCC boundary. And then once I knew it was in the GNLCC boundary, it made it very easy for me to determine which habitat they prioritized. For instance, in Oregon, the Blue Mountains, the Columbia Plateau, and a small section of the East Cascades are within the GNLCC boundary. And so, for instance, for Blue Mountains, I knew that aspen woodlands, freshwater aquatic habitats, ponderosa pine woodlands, riparian habitats, sagebrush habitats, and wetlands were all considered priority habitats for that particular ecoregion. So I want to show you an example from Idaho. Idaho did something real similar. So let's just go through that. So here's the ecoregional map for Idaho, and so you can see where the boundaries are for those ecoregions. It was really clear to me which ones were in the GNLCC. So I'm going to take you through an example of how I did the priority habitat crosswalk using this Yellowstone Highlands. So I knew Yellowstone Highlands was in. There was a chapter specifically devoted to the Yellowstone Highlands in the swap. This is what it looked like. They identified the priority habitat and the species within that ecoregion that they had listed as greatest conservation need. I'm going to take you through the example for upland deciduous forest. Okay? So once I realized that upland deciduous forest was in the Yellowstone Highland ecosystem or ecoregion, I had to go to the appendix and read the veg description for that. There were three veg descriptions for the broader category of upland deciduous forest. And after reading the descriptions, I knew which one was in the Yellowstone Highlands. Okay, it's the Rocky Mountain aspen forest and woodland system. And I was so happy Idaho and Wyoming and one other state, I can't remember which, actually used NatureServe ecological classifications, which I eventually did the giant crosswalk for everything to match up with because I needed a common language to describe the habitats across all the states. So I knew that was the habitat that I was working with. So I did that for all of the priority habitats listed in all the states in all the ecoregions in the swaps. So I recorded which habitats they were. I read the habitat descriptions in all the swaps and compared those to the NatureServe ecological classification system. And then I created a big crosswalk of priority habitats. And this is what I came up with. You can see on this slide how differently the habitats were named. So this is why I had to go and read the descriptions, just to make sure I was dealing with the right ones. So there are three habitats that floated to the top as priority habitats common to all five states. And that's the Rocky Mountain aspen forest and woodland ecosystem, the Rocky Mountain subalpine montane riparian shrubland, and the Intermountain Basin's big sagebrush steppe. So I got that again by reading the descriptions of the habitats in all of the swaps, comparing them to NatureServe, and felt pretty confident that that's the system that we're dealing with. These veg class systems also correlate to the gap level 3 land cover analysis, as an aside. So then there were six priority habitats common to four states. Here they are here, Northern Rocky Mountain, Ponderosa Pine, Woodland, and Savannah. Northern Rocky Mountain, Lower Montane, Riparian Woodland, and Shrubland. Rocky Mountain, Subalpine, Montane, Riparian Woodland. North American Arid West, Emergent Marsh. Intermountain Basins, Montane, Sagebrush Steppe. And the Intermountain Basins, Sagebrush Shrubland. So again, we're seeing those representations of sage steppe being pretty important. And that makes sense because so much of the GNLCC is sage steppe. So no surprise there. So then once I had all those habitats together, I gave the list to Rick. And I will now give the mic to Rick.
So one of the things we thought would be useful is to look at the key habitats for the 15 species that ranked 5 or higher on the earlier list, and try to come up with some sort of description of the habitats that those 15 species inhabit, and thinking about them from the standpoint of whether those habitats are inhabited by species that I would think of as obligate or facultative species. And the idea, of course, was to make sure that we weren't looking at habitats that had only facultative species, or at least trying to, and I guess it's not a problem looking at those that have just facultative, but I think it's important to be able to distinguish which of those, the total species, which ones are, how many are obligate and how many are facultative. And so essentially we narrowed all those habitats down, it looked like, into really these six broad categories, and obviously they're very broad, but grassland, steppe, and sage had six species. And this obligate facultative cut was one that I just did based very subjectively by looking at the species and trying to get an idea as to where I thought they were listed. Wetland, riparian open water, there were 5 species, forest, 3 species, cool and cold water streams, 2 species, open forest, 1 species, and generalist, 2 species. This is one of the things you can do in ARC, obviously, is do frequency distributions of different categories. And this is similar to an earlier slide that we had that shows on the broad category on the left, I believe it's brown, even though my eyes tell me it's red, and the one on the right that I'm told is green, and my eyes tell me it's yellow because I'm so colorblind. But in any case, the brown on the left and the green represent the shrubland, steppe, grassland, and savanna, as well as the forest and woodland. And I think the take-home message here again is they're really fairly equal in distribution across the Great Northern and how they contribute to the species diversity as represented by those 27 species. And that's something I noticed that Leslie emphasized earlier, and I'll emphasize again. We are looking at a kind of species diversity in those maps in this analysis, but it is an analysis of those 27. We could do more and more, and we could do a more traditional kind of species diversity kind of classification, but our attempt was, again, in all of this, was to try to establish some sort of understanding of the commonality and the priority that the states had given to conservation for the species across the Great Northern. So then in summary, what we'd like to first do again is thank Greg Watson for making the idea of doing this analysis, because we think it was useful to do, and it helped us at least from we on the technical side here in the Great Northern get a better feel for what exists in the great in the landscape, and hopefully it did for the advisory team and the steering committee as well. But we did come up with this list of 27 species that you saw earlier. I don't think there's any real surprises here. The thing that really makes me understand that there weren't any surprises is there was a lot of overlap. Each of the states had identified these species. The Great Northern, through strategic habitat conservation process, identified a bunch of those as well. I think it's probably a pretty sound list of those common species across the Great Northern. So what are some of the next steps? We sort of like to look a little more at the frequency distribution of land cover types in each of the classifications so that we can examine the habitat types that represent those really diverse polygons. And by diverse polygons, we're talking about the diversity of within those 27 species. But we'd also like to hear other people's ideas as sort of what the next steps might be. Maybe we will take this further, maybe we won't. We don't really know. We're sort of in that discussion phase now, sort of what's next. And we'd be really pleased to hear people's ideas as to what might be useful in terms of thinking about priorities across the Great Northern from a fish and wildlife species perspective as well as their habitats. And lastly, one afternoon, Tom Olaf and I, who serves as one of the co-coordinators for the Great Northern, sat down and sort of roughed out a conceptual diagram of how one might look at sort of overall project values when you're thinking about landscape conservation. And the idea of providing this to you today is not to suggest that we came up with a great answer. The idea of presenting it today is to emphasize the complexity of trying to identify those priorities and recognizing that this was just a quick attempt at doing so. There's lots of improvements that could be made in this one, and we'll probably do that as time goes on. This is more for us, for our benefit of thinking about how this whole process works. And if you look at the top left, you'll see one circle that says swap species rank. Part of the reason for including this diagram is to recognize that when we look at swap species, and as we did, it's only one small part of this whole idea of thinking about GNLCC priorities. But we still think it's important to think about, and we think it fits in the whole picture. And this is sort of Tom and my sort of rough way of taking a first cut at looking at how that might come together. And with that, we'd like to again thank Tara for doing a lot of the GIS analysis. She wasn't able to join us today because of a family a death in her family that she was attending to in Nebraska. But we really want to thank her for her expertise. And with that, we'll be happy to entertain any questions. Start with folks on the phone. Anyone, any questions? Anybody in the room?
So what do you think, now that you guys have all the base work down, what do you think the next steps are, Rick, for dealing with taking priority species and thinking about them within the context of state management objectives, climate change, resource allocation? Where do you guys think you want to take this next?
It's a great question. Greg's question was, now that we sort of have taken a first cut at this swap analysis, where do we want to take it in terms of thinking about priorities in the Great Northern? And I think, and particularly in relation to climate and land use change, I think maybe you mentioned it's climate change, not land use change. I think one of the key things here is we want to go to our partners and engage them in that process. It's not something that we do for them. We might build a process so that they can sort of develop those kind of priorities themselves. But the whole idea behind the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative is for the partners to identify those priorities. And so how we're actually going to go about that and engage that discussion, I guess we're not sure yet. Certainly through the advisory team and through the steering committee is sort of the initial stages. You know, that's a subjective way of doing that. And what we'd like to do, and I think maybe what you're alluding to, is trying to get some more empirical data into that. And some of the things that we're really happy that the Great Northern has done this year is funded projects. And the person that asked the question is Greg Peterson. And one of the projects that's been funded is for him to begin to look at help folks across the Great Northern in the field understand what we mean by climate change. I don't mean what we mean. What is sort of the essence of climate change across the Great Northern, and how that can be used at the local level and at the landscape level. And so I think all that ties together, Greg, in terms of helping people get them more information so that they can establish those priorities. Certainly, there's no attempt there's no attempt from the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative's perspective to try to establish priorities for the states. That's the farthest thing from our intent. the intent is to, for the whole group to think about their own priorities in a landscape context. And I think one of those landscape contexts that you alluded to is that the drivers of those landscape processes, one of the ones that everyone is really concerned about these days, is climate change. So it's that landscape driver of climate change and how we can begin to use that for individual agencies' priorities is where we really need to go next. And it's really a subjective discussion next, and then to begin to pull in experts like yourself in terms of trying to understand the uncertainties and everything else associated with those landscape drivers. I don't know if that's a sort of a dancing around a little bit of, around your question, but it's part of the process, and this is just sort of the start of that process. You know, what one might be able to do is to begin to look at the effects of specific climate change on this list of species, as sort of a first cut as well. There's some of those things like that that could be done when you begin to look at what the common species are.
We have a question from the. Audience, yes. How were the boundaries of the GNLCC determined?
That was a process that was done on an international scale, and I don't know all of the details, but in the very, very early stages, before all the LCCs were identified, they basically took the bird conservation regions that were established under the NABC, and I always forget, the National North American Bird Conservation Initiative, I believe that's from. And essentially what they did is they took and recombined those bird conservation regions in ARC and made those what they felt were larger regions that represented common eco-regions, if you will. And then there were some areas where they felt like specific watershed boundaries also were used to sort of inform where those landscape conservation boundaries were made. And it was sort of a collaborative process amongst a bunch of folks that brought those landscape conservation cooperative boundaries together. One of the things that you always talk about when you talk about LCC boundaries, however, is that they're intended not to be specific lines on the map, even though they are. They're really intended to be a general kind of regions. And so when you get to the edges of the region, you can sort of ignore, if you will, which LCC boundary you're in because there is so much overlap. The classic example for us in the Great Northern is our common boundary with the Plains and Prairie Pothole Landscape Conservation Cooperative. You look on the Rocky Mountain front, and it's really a very, very fuzzy boundary there. There are a fair amount of mountain ranges in eastern Montana, for instance, that are included in the Plains and Prairie Pothole Landscape Conservation Cooperative. So these things are meant to be general kind of things for general landscape planning and not meant to be real specific ecological boundaries, although they are based on the specifically on the bird conservation regions. Does that answer your question enough, or do you have a follow-up to that? Okay, you can type in another question because I guess you can't actually talk back to us, but we can see your questions when you type them in. So, Virginia Kelly has a question. Have any thoughts on identifying plant species of concern at the Great Northern scale? thoughts, yes. More than thoughts, probably not. I guess it depends sort of a little bit on the next generation of swaps. If the next generation of swaps were to begin to look at plants and plants of particular concern, those might be included. I think that there are a number of other planning efforts that are going on at the landscape level or at sub-landscape level by folks like the Forest Service and the BLM and the regional ecosystem assessments of BLM. A lot of those are based upon plants and habitat types. So in that sense, Virginia, there's as we get farther and farther into this with our partners, they may say, now we've got better data sets for plants and for habitats, and we might begin to look at that. But specifically, at this stage, we don't have any plans to do that unless our advisory team and the steering committee says, that's really a good idea and we should move forward, then we would. See, the next question is, how did you get over 200 species of greatest conservation needs for Montana with over 80 being invertebrates. We only have 60 species of greatest conservation need in our SWAP, and only one is an invertebrate.
I think we'd have to go back and look at our list from the NBII, and I think to address Deb's concern with that, we'd have to go back and look at our original list from the NBII and see what's listed there. That also is the same thing for Deb's next question, which is pelicans are abundant and common, and we had them in the had them as greatest conservation needs for all state, and Deb's saying it's not in Montana. So again, I would just have to go back and look at the original lists that I got from the NBII and see if they're included. Because if they are, then that's something that we would want to address at that level.
Well, one of the things that there's a real opportunity for confusion when we were doing this, and that may, the pelican may be one that fits in that category, I'm not sure. In a state like Montana that has multiple LCCs in it, it could have been a species in the Plains and Prairie Pothole LCC, and we might not have we might have missed that on our filter in terms of filtering it out. So we'll double check that one. Thanks, Deb. Did you have a question, Kath, before?
Well, I was curious about the slide where you had the species, but you didn't have the species list. Do you guys have that slide with the list of the species with the where you did the obligate? I'm just curious what those species were.
Kathy Irvin has asked a question about when we went down to the six habitat categories and we had the facultative and obligate species. She was wondering which of those species those were. I'm not sure I can remember off the top of my head, Kath, so I'd rather get back to you later on it. But some of the grassland steppe sage species obviously would have been the grouse species. Some of the waterfowl species, maybe. No, I don't think that. Those could fit in the wetland species.
Pygmy rabbit.
Pygmy rabbit. The owl, the burrowing owl. Again, I'm not quite collecting up on those. I think we better have to go over that later, and I could be more specific. The wetland riparian open water species tended to be the waterfowl and the crane. I think maybe I put in the bald eagle there too because of its preference on water. Forest species were, I believe, if I included in there, the mule deer, bighorn sheep, and I think I'd have to look again, I'm not sure. There was one other bird species, I'm not positive. This cool and cold water stream were the fish species, obviously. The open forest species, if I remember right, was Lewis's woodpecker because it's a more open forest species. In the generalist, I think I included, I may have included the mule deer here or not in the forest, I've forgotten. And I believe the peregrine falcon might have been a generalist as well. But so that's sort of how I did it. Good question. I don't remember off the top of my head because it's been a couple months ago since I did it. So, with no other questions, I guess we'll thank everybody for joining in and we'll talk to you again.